Good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to have Dr. Ganesh Natarajan with us today. Ganesh is the chairman of 5F World, Lighthouse Communities, and Pune City Connect. He's a board member for organizations such as SBI, GTT, Calzone Advisors, Hinduja Global Solutions, amongst many others. A philanthropist, an entrepreneur, and a leading visionary in the learning and development space and the human resources space. Ganesh is keenly interested in the role of digital technologies for re-engineering processes in the corporate and social sector and is an author of 8 books and numerous articles. Ganesh, may I now request you to take us through your presentation on the topic of what has happened in the last 8-9 months in the L&D and human resource space, and would really like to hear your views of where we are heading in 2021.
Good. Thank you very much, Neeti, and always a pleasure to be with you and, of course, the Team Lease community. Your founder, Manish, is a good friend, and it's really amazing to see the kind of great work that Team Lease has done over the years and continues to do. And good afternoon to all of you. And it's my pleasure to actually share some ideas and some research. As most people in human resources will know, L&D and the whole learning process is a ongoing moving target. So nobody can really predict exactly what will happen. But we started doing some serious research on new trends, the impact of digital on learning, and indeed on everything else in the last 3 years or so. And of course, like everything else in this world, it was thrown out, the spanner was thrown into the works by COVID. So let me start there and kind of take you through a little journey for maybe 20, 25 minutes. And then we can just have an interaction. And if any of you have questions or suggestions, let's make it interactive. So feel free to post your comments or questions in the chat box. And of course, I'm sure Neeti will be nice and give you a chance to ask questions towards the end. So let me just upload my presentation. Great, can you see this? You're seeing this, Neeti? Yes, you are. Okay, perfect. So let's start here. I mean, I'm calling this, it's a very ambitious title, but we're saying reimagining learning and development for a digital world, because we all know that the process of digitalization of this world started off in 2015, and it's kind of gathered momentum slowly, and then gathered momentum extremely fast in the last 10 months. Let's talk about that a little bit. So if you look at, I think we are now in what we really call the perfect storm. And this, most of you in HR would know that, I mean, if you look at the first chart, I think we're talking about 52% of Fortune 500 have either been finished in one way or the other. Okay, they've gone bankrupt, acquired, whatever. If you look at the next one, we are finding that COVID, of course, is causing a significant rethink, and the kind of rethink that, you know, the way countries are looking at it, companies are looking at it, society is looking at it is very, very different. And I will talk a little bit about the impact on India as a country right at the end of this presentation. And of course, the way we think of people, I mean, people were, at least in the IT industry where I come from, 45 lakh people were just showing up on campuses and offices and going back home. And we were actually paying for input, people showing up. And of course, they did good work. But now we have to really think of, you know, the gig worker, the person working from home, and really see how to motivate them, how to manage them, how to lead them. So I think that's important, and we'll come to that. World Economic Forum predicted that by 2025, 75 million jobs will be displaced by automation. And of course, because of any automation or any technology also creates a whole bunch of jobs. And what they call the fourth industrial revolution, which is the extensive use of digital technology, would also create 133 million new jobs. So this was where we were, I would say, at January of 2020. And then we said that, look, I mean, will the new learning organization completely be different from where we are? What happened because of COVID? Let's kind of take stock because of that. First of all, of course, we found that global markets have completely changed. I mean, for some strange reason, which nobody really has understood. I'm just coming out of a seminar full of fund managers, and we were discussing why the stock markets continue to go up in the US and in India. What is it that they're seeing that many of us have not seen? Of course, the ILO warned about 25 million layoffs and probably expecting that 190 million jobs would be lost by the end of the crisis. Thanks to the stimulus packages in the US, UK, and many other places, I mean, it hasn't really affected people so much because people still got their money, albeit from the government. But in places like India, developing countries, which don't have the fiscal capability to provide that kind of money to people, I think they're seeing a lot of stress in the economy, in families, et cetera. We all know that, I mean, the Indian economy declined by 24.9% in the first quarter. It nicely recovered a little bit in the sense that the decline was less than 12% in the second quarter. And the hope is, what our finance minister has been promising, is that maybe we will end up at the end of the year at maybe a 9% decline, which if you look at it is still disastrous. Because even if next year on a low base, we grow by 12%, we would effectively be in the same place in March of 2021, as we were in March of 2019. So it's almost like 2 years just lost because of COVID. And I think we'll find that, I mean, we're already seeing that. We saw it with the migrant crisis. We are seeing it currently with the whole farmers issue. But there will be a lot of deaths due to unemployment, displaced workers. So the COVID death itself, which is less than the common cold or the flu, will be small in comparison to the devastation it has caused to the economy. Interestingly, a few interesting things have happened. As I mentioned earlier, and we'll come back to this, but COVID has really changed the whole concept of the workplace. I was talking to my friend CP Gurnani of Tech Mahindra just about 4 days back in a different webinar. It was a conversation. And he made a very interesting point. I mean, he was saying that, look, we were used to 50, 60 global offices. Now we're getting used to 1.25 lakh global offices. I mean, where is the 1 lakh office come from? If people are, everybody's working from home, I mean, effectively, I'm working from my home today. So my office is fully set up. I've got my iPad here, my mobile phone, the computer I'm talking to you on. I have, of course, to have my television set on the right-hand side where I will quickly peek at the Indian score against Australia. So all this is a way of life, and our offices are very different from, you know, going and sitting in an office with maybe 100 people, 200 people, 2,000 people. What we're also seeing is the natural spiking of internet traffic. So 50 to 70% growth literally every quarter. And we'll come back to this, new ways of interacting, new ways of learning. Reskilling, upskilling, all these are terminologies which are becoming, I mean, almost inevitable. And in fact, it started with, I'm sure some of you would have read these two wonderful books of Professor Noel Harari. The first one was called Homo Deus. The first one is called Sapiens, which was a history of the last 2000 words. And then he wrote his, what I think is a magnificent book called Homo Deus, which is the history of the next 100 years, as he calls it, which is really a peep into the future. And we'll, if we get a chance in the Q&A, maybe I'll talk to you a little bit about my own insights from Harari, which are absolutely fascinating. And this I mentioned, I mean, there'll be multiple millions of jobs will be created. There'll be a demand for new roles, there'll be AI, and we'll talk about it. Interestingly, a lot of companies, I mean, if you take Microsoft or Facebook in the US, I mean, potentially right till the third quarter of next year, people will work from home. Facebook has actually said nobody needs to come to office. Even in Indian companies, people, including Tata Consulting Services, have said that, look, work from home will be a reality. I mean, 2 days ago, my friend Salil Parekh, the CEO of Infosys, also talked about the blended way of learning being the complete new paradigm. And what it means for that is what we need to think about. I'm not too happy as a social worker in India to see 1 crore people permanently working from home, because what that will mean, if you calculate, is 1.5 crores people will lose their jobs. Not those people, but people in security, in transportation, in healthcare services, in hospitality. Because if everybody works from home, the demand on various other logistics issues will just go down. So I think that's a bit of an issue, but that we won't talk about right now. A few thoughts on digital transformation. What does it mean? I mean, if you look at digital transformation today, it's affected every sector. But I was doing a session on digital in Abu Dhabi, and not with this slide. And I actually made the mistake of saying that, look, except for oil and gas, you know, every industry is affected. And one guy got up, I'm saying, look, I'm from ADNOC, which is one of the big Abu Dhabi corporations. I said, how can you say digital? We are the most effective user of digital technology. So I apologize. I said, look, I mean, today I'm putting it at the bottom of the chart. But don't think it's a bottom. I mean, even they are using digital very, very substantially for all kinds of things, for automation, for Internet of Things, et cetera. And I won't talk about digital, not on the purpose, but literally everything is going. And how does this translate to L&D, which is what we're here to talk about? This is a book we're just writing. In fact, it should be published first quarter of next year by Bloomsbury. And we really did a year and a half of research before we wrote this book. Idea being that if you reimagine organizations post-COVID, I mean, we are assuming that a vaccine will be there, we'll all get vaccinated. Hopefully by April, May, we'll all be back to normal. But even then, the organization will be completely different from what it was pre-COVID. So we're really talking about these issues. And what I'm going to tell you is a bit of our research from that book. So we really look at, when you look at a digital organization, And all of us will be digital organizations, whether we like it or not. We'll either be dragged to being digital or we will consciously want to be digital. But effectively, you have to reimagine multiple things in a digital organization. First is stakeholder journeys. I mean, we'll talk about both customers and the employees, which is, I'm sure, the topic you want to hear. And of course, we won't talk about supply chains and digital and demand chains. Everything is transformed. All the journeys or the way people consume information, goods, services is changing because of digital. And we also found that apart from the journeys, all processes are being changed. I mean, I used to do a lot of sessions when I was in AppTech 25 years ago, 20 years ago. And we used to talk about this, in fact, myself and my first co-author, a gentleman called M.S. Jayaraman. And Jay used to say that, look, technology will become extremely common. I mean, everybody will be used to fifth generation technology, which is what we're seeing today. But we mustn't forget that the processes will remain third generation and the people might well remain first generation. And I'll come to the people later. But what does third generation process mean? That the process was designed for occasional computerization. But today, digital is everywhere. It's 24/7. It's hitting you everywhere. And if you try an old process and new digital, you're wasting money. So you have to do process re-engineering. Data and analytics, which of course is the biggest deal in town, because today everybody is talking about data as a new oil and how do you move from post-mortem analytics to predictive, prescriptive analytics, becoming extremely important for an HR person in recruiting, in L&D, in attrition management, everything. Fourth, how do you not just rely on your internal ecosystem, but how do you, embrace startups, embrace new ideas? I mean, we've now invested in a company called Skills Alpha, which is being embraced by many large corporations saying, hey, I want a digital platform for learning and development. So the innovation ecosystem becomes extremely important. And finally, the point we'll end with, which is what is the new culture, the new way of acquiring skills as we go along. So the point I'm making is organizations will be digitally successful, not if they buy the latest and greatest technologies, but if they, you will notice that there's no mention of the word technology here. Because we're saying technology is a given, but it's stakeholder journeys, process re-engineering, data and analytics, innovation, culture and skills. That will determine your success. And you can see the integral role or the pivotal role that many of you who are in HR will play in this matter. The new customer journey, and I won't get into this. If any of you want these slides, I'm sure Neeti and team can send it to you. There's no confidentiality to these slides. But if you look at customers, I mean, there was a time when we bought something, we actually made the effort to go to a Shopper Stop or go to a mall or go to wherever. I remember going with my daughter to buy, she wanted to buy a dress and she lives in New York. And we went across maybe 20 stores in Fifth Avenue, New York. And at the end of 8 hours, she still hadn't found something she liked. I mean, and then you tried stuff, et cetera. Today, there's no need whatsoever. I mean, virtual reality can enable you to try on 40 dresses in 20 minutes from any store of your choice. So digital is changing everything. So the awareness of brands is happening through digital. The consideration or the testing is happening through digital. Price discovery and the eventual decision to purchase may happen in the store, may happen on your computer. It may happen from a mobile phone. It may happen while you're in a bus. It doesn't make a difference. Servicing is also changing and loyalty, in terms of how you decide who to use, et cetera, everything is changing. So I'm saying the customer journey is going in ways that are almost unimaginable. I spent a year as digital advisor to McKinsey & Company in New York. And we, for an insurance company, we actually could craft out almost 47 new digital journeys that people could go through, as against the old journey of somebody just shopping around and buying an insurance policy. So this is critical. And moving to the people dimension, and just take maybe 8-9 more minutes. See, many of you are maybe aware, there was a movie where there was this entity called Eva, and that's what she looked like. Today, there is a very, very famous robot called Sophia. In fact, we even brought Sophia to an industry conference last year. Sophia, by the way, got awarded as an honorary citizen of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia because she actually can have a conversation with you. And today, when you look at robots are becoming so similar in terms of thinking that except for your instinctive likes and dislikes, which will also change, robots and humans are almost coexisting. I have a client in China in a place called Shenzhen, where I remember when I first started working with them, they had 2,000 people working on a shop floor manufacturing electronic chips. Today it's come down to 300 people and 1,200 robots. And each person manages 4 robots. So it's a coexistence of physical and digital, which is, let's say, humans and robots, and all that is changing. So what differentiates humans is natural intelligence and artificial intelligence. And if you look at AI, I mean, this is something that we are seeing as the key trends happening. Future-focused skills. I mean, nobody can get away with saying, this is what Harari says. Okay, Harari says that, look, every 15 years, if every human being is not completely reskilled, you're probably obsolete already. And imagine in a 60-year, or maybe if you're living for 90 years, you need to have at least 4 different lifetimes in terms of skills. So that's what we call future-focused skills. Digital learning. I mean, obviously, nobody really wants to sit in a classroom. I mean, today, I find it very difficult to hold classroom attention for more than maybe 45 minutes. Everybody is like, you know, under the table, looking at their mobile phone, looking at WhatsApp, et cetera. So there's very little attention span. So we got to give people learning in digital nuggets. If somebody has a 10-minute time span, how can micro learning put enough information into that 10 minutes? So I think that's the digital learning concept we're seeing. And most people are saying that informal learning, I mean, if you go to, for instance, if any of you have young kids, well, let's say in grade 1 or grade 2, you'll inevitably notice that, you know, while they're trying to act as though they're learning from their teacher on a computer, they're really watching their friends, looking at stuff, because there they were learning. And even in colleges, I mean, my daughter went to Cambridge in UK, and she kept saying, I never learned anything in that large lecture with 300 people. Where she learned was with 8 people, small group interaction, tutorials, etc. That is the informal learning base. And whether it's in organizations or universities or schools, informal learning is as important. And of course, on top of that, there is leadership development, there's 360 degree feedback. So many things we've been used to doing face-to-face, which now has to happen online. So just a few thoughts on the future of learning and development. You will find, obviously, for learning and development, there are 3 entities who are stakeholders. One is the person herself, which whom I mean, we're calling talent. Their line manager, which is the business and resource manager, and HR, which is, we're calling it development and engagement. So today, if you look at platforms like the one I mentioned, Skills Alpha, or at least, you know, Pluralsight, and quite a few others that you must be using, it's all about AI. Because when you now engage for a learning journey, it's about first understanding the aspirations of the person, understanding their style. I mean, will this person learn more by jokes or interaction or videos or whatever? So it's personalized learning, doing a complete assessment and skill gap analysis, and then building these personalized career paths. So skills is a science now. It's no longer just saying tick in the box and saying these 5 skills, but what skills, how do you impart them, in what frequency, artificial intelligence guided, et cetera, et cetera. And then the social learning piece, which is, you know, how do we ensure there's enough peer group interaction for them to learn, like I mentioned earlier? How do you find them a mentor, all on a platform? I mean, today, digital platforms are magical. So they can actually enable people to manage their own learning and be maybe 20, 30% more effective in managing their learning than by going into a classroom. And of course, any digital platform today integrates with what in jargon we call systems of records. Every one of you will have a learning management system in your organization, a human resource information system, a performance management system, et cetera. But how do you plant a digital platform on top of that, which makes the magic unfold? So this is what we're seeing. What that means is, to put it in a more pretty graph, that you have the AI bot sitting right at the left-hand side of that screen. But as I said, teamwork and collaboration, how do you enable that through digital? Internal social networks, how do you enable that through digital? How do you contextualize the learning resources? I mean, you can learn from YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, your own organization, Coursera, et cetera, et cetera. But how do you put everything together in a format where the lady there is actually learning most effectively? And this is, how do you personalize that? But she learns in a different way from her neighbor, but both of them are equally effective. And how does all that lead to individual learning, to corporate learning, to what we call knowledge management or knowledge workflows for the organization? And this is the beauty of today's learning processes. So just to conclude, if you look at blended learning, which I personally see as the way to the future, because no longer can we say that, because e-learning really doesn't work. I mean, I did a lot of work in Harvard Business School because I did my advanced management there. And after that, we were sitting around and talking about something called HBX. If any of you know the Harvard phenomenon, HBX is probably one of the most powerful learning methods. And they found, like everybody else finds, that normal e-learning is just not working. There's hardly 12% course completion rates. People just don't engage with normal e-learning. But when you combine that, like in Harvard, just to give you an example, we actually created a studio environment So a professor could be supported by AI. So when a professor had, let's say, 40 screens open in front of him, all the learners, the AI would prompt him saying, person in screen number 17, and it'll kind of glow, is actually not focusing on your class. Ask him this question. So it's almost like a guided method of saying that, look, AI will enable you to teach better. And I remember we got some very, very marquee professors to try this out, Michael Porter, Rosebeth Moss Cantor, et cetera. And all of them found this is a much more effective medium. That's the beauty of learning, okay, when you do blended learning. And today, if you go to a Harvard classroom, out of the 80 people that normally show up, maybe 30 people will be in class, socially distanced, other 50 are from their homes or wherever. And all of them are learning equally effectively. That's the power of new learning. So essentially, what are we saying? We're saying that mobile learning or mobile learning is extremely crucial. There's no way people are going to learn from computers all the time. I mean, it has to be available, mobile rendered. Peer-to-peer learning, I've already mentioned this in multiple contexts, whether it's in universities or learning from your best friend, even in the office environment. Data-driven processes that, you know, how do you, as I mentioned earlier, every stage of the process, how can you predict what will be the learning outcome? How can you prescribe that, look, why don't you watch this video? Because you believe that will enable them to this thing. It's a constant method of getting into the mind of the learner and saying, how do I customize for her so that she learns better? Which is the fourth point, the personalized learning experience. I mean, we do a lot of work on helping organizations to train their people for digital. And we found the best way to personalize the learning experience is to understand what somebody wants to do in digital. I mean, you've all heard the terms digital natives and digital immigrants. I'm a digital immigrant. I mean, when I grew up, I mean, we grew up with chunky landline telephones. But a 22-year-old Gen Z person today she can't even imagine a world without her digital or mobile phone. So I'm saying, how do you integrate the expectations of a 22-year-old with the learnings of a 55-year-old? I think, and how does everybody work together in a collaborative way? And micro-learning, I used the word earlier, for a new generation of learners with time spans of maybe 40 seconds to 30 to 3 minutes, how do you make nuggets of learning happen that will still add up to a larger base? So I think, you know, Neeti and I, for instance, were in a chat with the new Vice Chancellor of Delhi Skills University. And this is a discussion we were having, that how do you design for a skills audience, which is very different from the traditional, I will go and do my BA, BCom audience. And I'm sure, you know, Team Lees, with their wonderful work they're doing in their own skills university in Vadodara, are probably learning it as we go along. So all of us are learning, all of us are experimenting, and all of us are finding there is a completely new way. So I'm close by saying this, that, you know, if you don't solve the skills riddle, this is a skills riddle, okay? Because the jury is still out on how skills will actually happen in the world. In fact, we're doing a lot of work in NASSCOM with future skills, et cetera, to see how the whole country can acquire new skills while they're waiting in their homes for COVID to get over. But agility is important. Curiosity is important. Smart technology capabilities, I mean, using commonly available technology uncommonly well is extremely important. Then you can succeed. Otherwise, quite honestly, and I don't want to sound alarmist, but organizations that do not get this agenda will probably fade from existence. And that's said by a person called Marty Constant. And I'll end here by saying that, look, I'm excited. The opportunity with digital is tremendous. However much we fear, I think COVID will get over and we'll be faced with what we all talk about as a new narrative. But can you and me and everybody else, can we be ready for this new organization? I think that is the agenda that we should all be looking. So let me stop sharing and then let's have a conversation. Yes, Neeti.
Thanks, Ganesh. I think it's so interesting and we really look forward to your book coming in next month. So, and I'm sure there's a lot to learn from that book as well. There's a lot of research, as I see, has gone behind writing that book. So, you know, I mean, I have a laundry list of questions and I'm sure there'll be questions coming in from the audience. But let me start by some of my questions. You know, you mentioned that 75 million jobs will be displaced because of automation and another 130 will get, or 130 plus will get created, you know, which are really the newer, you know, I mean, we keep asking these questions, what are the new age jobs, right? But my question to you is, what will be the kind of skill sets that will be required for people to be prepared for these 130 million plus jobs that are going to be the future of our workplace?
You know, that's a great question, Neeti, because in NASSCOM, we actually 3 years back for the IT industry, we did this future of jobs research. Mm-hmm. We did that for CII along with Mr. Arun Myra, who I think most of you would have heard the name. And we were really imagining what kind of jobs would exist. So let me give you two or three dimensions. One is where will the jobs be? CP Gurnani is saying 1.25 lakh locations. So jobs will be everywhere. I mean, India's biggest problem, as you know, is massive urbanization. I mean, the way the seven cities, I mean, including the city I live in, Pune, are so overcrowded because everybody wants to come here. The lifestyle is better, the infrastructure is better, etc. But jobs will start getting distributed. I was doing a session like this for the Urban Management Association in Kerala. And those guys were telling me that, look, you know, in Kerala, every village has Wi-Fi connectivity. So why can't everybody work from their village? Absolutely. They should be able to. My daughter who lives in New York tells me that, look, most people are now moving out of New York and moving upstate. But they're saying, how does it matter? I mean, I can work from home. Why would I work from home in a small apartment in Manhattan?
Yeah.
Go to the Hudson Valley and have this wonderful farm and work from there.
Yeah.
The thing is, a massive redistribution of jobs. So that's one. So skilling will be differently enabled there. So when we did NASSCOM, the study, you'll be surprised. Because if you ask the same question 10 years ago about the IT industry, you'd say, okay, development, maintenance, testing, managing infrastructure were the big jobs. Today, if you look at the jobs that we are coming up with, it's user experience design, storytelling, believe it or not, storytelling. You were kids, if you told stories, you got caned. But today, storytelling is the most in demand. I mean, I'm basically nothing but a good storyteller, as you can imagine. Telling stories is so much in demand because it's communication, it's painting pictures, enabling... Yeah. Customer to see what the value is, enabling your customer to see what her journey could be. It's going to be very, very different. So I think the location of people will drive how you skill them. Isolation is a big issue for it. So even managers, are managers really capable of managing a team of 40 people in seven different cities, each with a different Wi-Fi and a bandwidth problem? No, they're not. Ensure that what they were used to managing a team of people sitting in their office, and suddenly it's a different ballgame altogether. So whether it's the, you know, motivation, entertainment. But I think skills are very different for technical skills. Requirement is completely different. You know, how do you manage a coffee conversation without having coffee with the person?
Yeah.
Managerial. So I think a lot of thinking has to go. And I mean, I don't want to generalize the answer, but I'm saying if you take technical skills, soft skills, and managerial skills, I think those are the categories for any learning and development head in an organization. But depending on what the organization is, you'll probably have to populate that skills matrix much better and then decide how to deliver the skills to.
Sure. You know, you mentioned soft skills, and you know, again, this whole debate about how important is soft skills versus hard skills. But going in the future with the kind of skills that you are just indicating, it just seems that the behavioral aspect or the emotional intelligence aspect is going to be a lot more critical for people across industries. Is that, you know, is that what you're seeing?
No, absolutely. And when you said soft skills, I mean, soft skills obviously is more than just emotional. Well, I remember when I was in school, as some of you know, I studied in a little village called Tatisilwa in Jharkhand. Don't ask me why I was there, but I was there. And the only school was a missionary school. And we were studying them, and right from class one till I finished my, in those days, what was called the Indian School Certificate, which became ICSC. I was there, and I remember suddenly in class 8 or 9, religion dawned on me, and I said, look, I must get into an IIT. First time I heard that word. And today, people, I think, hear IIT and they start preparing for it. But I went to my vice principal, he was a Fitzgerald, and we all used to call him Fitzy. And I told him, Fitzy, I want to get into IIT. Okay. So he started laughing, and I'll never forget that. He said, are you crazy? I said, why? He said, no, we don't teach you enough physics, chemistry, maths in the school for you to get into IIT. You need to be brilliant. I said, are you telling me I'm now 13 years old and my life is over because I came to this opportunity? He says, no, I didn't say that. Did I say that? I said, no. He told you can't get into IIT. Mm. We have taught you great English. English literature, which is true, but they were fantastic. But with English, what can I do, for heaven's sake? You know, everybody's talking about medicine and engineering. When you're 60 years old and you look back on your life, you say that, look, it's English that made your career, which is so true, okay?
Mm.
What is English ultimately? It's a soft skill. And English is not the language, it's the communication, it's your comfort with the language, okay, which more educated in English. And I think that's one soft skill. I mean, even when I go to the US and people ask me, okay, you teach in Harvard and you teach in Indian School of Business in either difference. The basic difference is very simple. I think I ask for questions. I mean, when I ask for that in Harvard Business School, out of 80 people, 60 hands will shoot up.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to communicate. Here in India, I'm sorry to say this, but even in the best of engineering and management schools, neighbor saying, are you going to ask the question or do I have to? Because we are inherently not a communicative society. I think we may be much smarter than the Americans, but and our job is to give those kind of skills, especially for people who have, you know, global operations, etc. Communicate. So you're absolutely right. So soft skills is all those aspects of being a more well-rounded human being. It's also the emotional skills of being able to deal better with people. I think that is an extremely critical part. And I'll just give you one more example. When I was running Zensar, and we were like this, you know, this big, we used to call it the love culture. So in fact, the Harvard case study on Zensar is about the love culture at Zensar. And I remember, you know, when we were 200 people, it was great, easy. When it was 2,000 people, not, we knew all the 1,999 people by name, by family. Suddenly we became 8,000. And when we were 6,000 people, we realized that this culture doesn't translate. It can't be a Ganesh Natarajan and five other people who are making it happen. So we said, okay, what do we train people on? And we applied the soft skills lens for the first time. And we found that in most managers, their biggest problem, okay, especially first-time managers who are, let's say, in their late 20s or early 30s, one was feedback. Okay, we are all terrible in giving feedback. And we are actually, we are more scared than the subordinate of the end of your appraisal. Because, oh my God, I have to give negative feedback. Whereas, you know, Americans give feedback all the time. So it's an on. That is one. Second is what we call development action planning. We care for people, but do we consciously have in mind that over the next 5 years, this is a development plan? It's changing. In large organizations, it's changing. And the third is connectedness. Now, how do you teach connectedness? How do I, you know, I used to tell people that, look, you know, how, when have you last taken your team out for dinner? Saying, no, that's not part of my job. I mean, that's HR's job. It's not my job. Then look, HR is not going to run your team. Mm-hmm. You are the line manager. You got to make it happen. Force people to be nice. Mm-hmm. So, you know, their willingness to be engaging, nice, what we call the connected manager, is a different science. So I think connectedness, feedback, development action planning, all these are skills. You're absolutely right. I think these are the skills that will define how we succeed in the new narrative, particularly, as I mentioned earlier, when people are not all around you and you can't have those coffee breaks and lunch, team lunches, it's going to become even more critical.
Yeah, absolutely. And with so much reskilling, upskilling you use in your presentation as well, and, you know, also the new skilling that's required, right? Do you foresee L&D becoming almost like a core function rather than a support function in organizations?
L&D should run the organization. I used to tell my L&D head, and he and I still laugh about it. I mean, we have a very, very bright Yogesh Patgaonkar, who was human resource head for RPG as well as for Zensar for many times. And I should tell Yogesh, I said, Yogesh, you are running this organization. It's you who are breathing life and soul into the organization. My job is to just make sure sales happens, we give enough to people, and they are like willing to really slog it out. And we've done that all the time, because we used to run all the people bottom line organization, people, planet, profits. And a lot of, because we were a public listed company. And I remember, you know, the typical Gujarati shareholder used to ask me, you know, what is the benefit of doing all this social work in an organization when you should be only looking at profits? I said, look, buddy, if you only look at profits, people are not going to be happy. If people are not happy, the planet is not going to be happy. We're not going to build communities. Together is what is important. And I don't deal with results. Our profitability was better than somebody else. People, especially young people who got engaged in CSR work, as real volunteers and not payroll givers, we found that our attrition as it is very low. I mean, we had overall attrition in Zensar of less than 12% against industry 18%, and critical talent was less than 3%. But people who got engaged in CSR, the attrition was down by 5% over the rest, which means they got more engaged with the organization because they were doing things beyond their KRA. I think it needs a different type of manager to make that. So I think that's the kind of organizations we need to build in the future, and which is why I said HR should lead and the CEO should follow what is the HR and the learning agenda that we create for people.
I think one last question from my end before we take the audience questions. You wrote one book on business process reengineering, which I had read it many years ago. What do you think is the reengineering required in the HR and the L&D space now?
You know, I wrote the next book after that, business process reengineering, was where we, the Gen Zs, in fact, a colleague of mine, Lavanya, and I wrote this book. It's called What Young People Really Want.
Okay. Uh-huh.
It's actually amazing. So if you look at, you talked about reengineering, mindsets, okay? And, you know, and I do multiple presentations on this thing. I mean, if you really look at categories of people we work with today, actually five categories, okay? Not even good old, old manager, new person kind of thing. I mean, it's the very old people like me, okay, who are like beyond the hill. Okay, that's one side. And don't forget, they're working in organizations.
So yeah.
Push them away. Then you've got what in America they call the baby boomers.
Hmm.
Who are typically at the CEO, CXO level, maybe in their... Then you've got the Gen X, if you call it, I mean, 40s. Then you've got the 35, maybe 36, Gen Y. And then you've got the Gen Z. Okay. And I mean, today, if you look at all these five, their aspirations, their willingness to listen, what they want, what they demand. So, I mean, I think it's the, depending on where you come from, is the HR manager's nightmare or the HR manager's dream to deal with five different aspirations at the same time in organizations. But if you can make that happen, I mean, if you can make that chemistry work, then you've got magic going on in the organization. I think that's really what I think we should be looking at. And that's how...
A lot of innovation and reinvention is required.
No, well, honestly, I'll sit in my corner office. HR, you go manage. We've got to educate the entire C-suite to get in this process.
So extremely important. And of course, upskilling the HR and the L&D folks is equally required, right? So I think that's a big vacuum that we have to start addressing now.
I agree, you know, because I mean, even the kind of HR we do, even in business schools, it's ancient. I mean, you got to get HR and L&D folks to be narrative. And somehow that's a bit missing, at least in India.
Absolutely, yes. So I have some questions. Let me just start reading them out to you, Ganesh. Okay, so one question. One question is, please share your views on Harari's books and how you see some of his thoughts becoming a reality in the near future.
I know I asked for it, right?
I know.
No, please read the book. Okay. Homo Deus, I mean, you can, if any of you, title means, Homo Deus is nothing but, I mean, Homo sapiens is, we all know.
Yeah.
That's where that biological term comes from. But he articulates Homo Deus as the person who's going to live into the century. So if you imagine this, and Harari talks about two or three things. Okay. One is, he says that, look, medical science is going to go beyond our imagination. So you could well imagine a situation where maybe not my generation, but maybe your generation, let's say somebody who's now 35 years old or 40 years old, could well imagine that if you take care of yourself and don't go to too many pubs all the time, you could live till the age of 100.
Mm.
I would hate to live to the age of 100. So let me do a rain check on that one. But suppose somebody wants to live to the age of 100. Now, Harari makes a very interesting point, saying today you're 35 years old, okay, and you want to live up to 100, and maybe you want to work, at least be productive till you're 80 years old. A lot of people are doing that now, especially if you're running your own business. I mean, the whole thing of I'm going to retire at the age of 58 or 60, doesn't that right? I mean, for me, I mean, I'm 63 years old. I don't see myself retiring, or, I mean, I'll either die or I'll still be working as hard as I do till 75. So, I mean, I still have probably 12 years to go, and people have 45 years to go if you're 30 years old, okay. So Harari says, if you're going to have a career for the next 45 years, okay, let's say from 30 to 75, every 15 years, your skill sets have to change. So he talks about the truck driver, you know, suddenly 15 years from now, there will be no trucks in America because everything will be wireless transmission. I mean, why do you need a truck driver to drive on this long road that never ends in America? Okay, so I think in that case, what does a truck driver do? And he said, truck driver will think a lot and say, oh, maybe I should become a yoga instructor. So he goes and does the BKS Iyengar courses and becomes a great yoga instructor. By the time it's 2030, he wants to become a yoga instructor. All yoga is being done by AI and robots. Human being to contort yourself that much. The robot will do it much better, right? I mean, Sophia will do it much better, the one I showed you. So then he says, oh my God, what do I do? So he says, you got to keep thinking. I'll keep learning. I mean, a lot of people ask me that, look, why do you have four colleges in your bio data? Because I went to I went to NITI to do industrial engineering, did my PhD in IIT Bombay, then did my management in Harvard Business School. But these were not one after the other. These points in my life when I said I need to go back and re-irrigate myself, okay, to really give myself more knowledge, more ideas. It was 2008. And it was the most cathartic experience of my life. So I'm saying exactly what Harari is saying, that you've got to keep re-educating yourself, keep getting new skills, and keep staying relevant and keep staying excited about the future. Why am I writing this book? Because the research we did gave us so much joy in terms of understanding what BCG thinks, what BCG thinks, what the various CEOs we interviewed think, what HR managers think, which is our favorite theme, that now, in fact, I mean, we're planning to start writing a new book on HR in the next quarter. So hopefully we'll do that book as well. Interestingly, Harari makes another point saying, another thing you got to keep in mind is while you stay relevant, he also says that remember that you got to continue to look good. A very facetious one, so forgive me for this. But if you don't know, so you may ask, why do you need to look good, for heaven's sake? He says it's very likely that if you live till the age of 100, the person who married you when you were 25 years old is not going to stay with you for 75 years. Either you will get fed up of, or she will get fed up. So in that case, what do you do? So you better keep looking good, otherwise nobody look at you again. Okay, this is a very facetious one that you would never expect Yuval Noah Harari to do, but he's saying that. So he's saying every aspect of your work, your life, start rethinking and plan for a long period. It's an amazing book. And whether you follow his advice or not, it'll give you ways to think about your life, which will actually transform you. And your point, Niti, on do HR heads and people need to be re-educated? Absolutely. But if our own thinking doesn't flow out in that direction, nothing is going to change. And just one anecdote I'll give you. In fact, the Harvard Business School case study on Zensar came about in a very interesting manner. I went to the AMP, then I remember 2 years later in 2010, this gentleman of a very favorite professor of mine called David Garvin, HBS. So David and I were on a flight in between Boston and New York, and we just generally chatting and said, hi David, how are you doing? And David said, so how's your company doing? He said, when you came to Harvard, I remember you had 3,000 people and XXX. I said, like right now we have 5,000 people and doing very well. And David said, what's the secret of your success? So I was just, after two glasses of wine, you were just feeling funny. So I said, it's love, David. I love my people and my people love me. So David is not a person who takes jokes. So he says, are you serious? Can I write a case study about this? I said, you feel free. Before I know it, before I'm back in India, my secretary says that, look, there is a team of 7 people coming from Harvard and they want to understand the love culture of Zensar. Okay. And if any of you want, I mean, I'll mail you that case study. It's amazingly well written. But David is one of the best professors I've ever met. But he's kind of written about how do you create a culture that people want to do stuff rather than saying, here's my KRA, do I do this or not? Okay, so I'm saying these are the kind of things that we have to start thinking about to build organizations of the future.
And it will be very interesting to read the case study, Ganesh. I'll actually reach out to you to get it, because I think each one of us could actually implement it in our organizations with our teams. So.
No, but you have to believe in it. Okay, you can't fake love. You know that, Niti. But
absolutely, yes. You'll get caught very soon. Okay, so I have a question here which says, how will corporate India help in using the power of its CSR budgets to enable reverse transition? I'm assuming it means reverse migration and upskilling of workforce to meet new age skill sets.
I hope it means reverse migration. Correct answer. Yeah. See, I think the point I was making earlier, we're doing a lot of work. I mentioned Arun Mayra.
Yeah.
Wonderful analysis on the distribution of jobs. So one of the things we should attempt again, as I said, I do a lot of these webinars. So I was doing one for, and this gentleman from Guwahati said that, look, during COVID, especially the almost 1.5 lakh people who are from Assamese origin came back to Guwahati. And sad to say, but there are no jobs. I mean, maybe there's some jobs in Guwahati, but in rural Assam, very few jobs. Okay? I mean, maybe in agriculture, maybe a little bit. So we're saying, why don't you people, the IT companies, the manufacturing companies, come set up? You know, why do people ask this question? And why do you think CEOs always ignore that? You should learn from China. I mean, China about 15 years back, and we were thinking where to set up a software center in China. Somebody said, go visit this new place called Zhuhai. I don't know if you've heard of the town Zhuhai. So I said, I never heard of Zhuhai. They said, look, boss, it's only a 40-minute ferry ride from Hong Kong. It's if you go from Shenzhen or from Hong Kong, it's kind of a triangle. Zhuhai is an island, and then you have. So I said, okay, I have a Saturday. Let me go to Zhuhai. So I just went to Zhuhai. First thing I noticed was, I mean, the ferry station was so sophisticated. Okay, and then we went to the mayor. The mayors are very easy to meet, unlike in India, in China. And the mayor told me that, you know, we have 7 golf courses. Our airport is bigger than 90%. And I said, but why? How many people live here? He said, no, right now it's a few hundred people live in Zhuhai. But they've built the infrastructure, you know, completely. And today Zhuhai is a hopping place. Okay? In fact, a lot of Japanese are now setting up there. And, you know, so many towns you haven't heard of, like our common friend Renu lives in Shanghai. But if you go to Hangzhou, you go to Wuxi, all these are little towns, but each one of them is like, I mean, this place, Suzhou, is like the Venice of China. I mean, it's actually better than Venice. Go to Macau, for instance. So I'm saying that's how they built this place. In India, if you go to any other, I mean, even if you drive 20 kilometers outside Pune, your Wi-Fi will keep collapsing. Okay, our infrastructure sucks. So China, they say physical infrastructure, that's one, roads, digital infrastructure, you should be able to work from anywhere in China, and social infrastructure. Why is he building golf courses? To make sure that there's social infrastructure. I mean, when Pune from Mumbai in 2001, I was probably one of very few people as a CEO. But if I look at the transformation of Pune, because many of us live there today, Pune is as much of a first world city as any other place. Yeah. But it's not happened in many cities. So we have 70 cities to become hubs of commerce. So we need that distribution. And I think that's what will probably change the space of this country.
Yeah, absolutely. The next question I have is that you spoke about informal learning. How do you implement informal learning, which is small group learning in distributed frontline workforce?
You know, it's a great question. And I'll give you actual research that's being done. Something called Globant. And if you haven't heard of it, just Google them. Globant is an absolutely stunning company. Most of my IT CEO friends get very upset when I talk about Globant. They'll say, oh my God, Ganesh fir chalo ho gaya. It's a little $300 million company, $1.8 billion market capitalization. It was set up by 4 Argentinian footballers. So there's a friend of mine called Martin Migoya, who's the CEO of Globant. And if you go to the Globant website, you'll see stuff that, I mean, you'll see words you haven't used. Augmented collaboration, for instance. And I think as HR heads, please see it. And in fact, register for their seminars. They do a seminar every 6 weeks on what's the future of people, etc. So Globant has one theory, by the way. It's very interesting. I was talking to Martin the other day. So he's saying that, look, we're now researching exactly your question. See, everybody's working from home. How do you recreate? Remember, you know, I don't know if any of you remember that we used to go to office once, okay? And then office, you know, you had that casual meeting and at the coffee counter, and you were having coffee and somebody else came in and say, hi, who are you? And you discovered, oh my God, this is a nice guy. And then you went out for lunch one day and you become a great friend and you learn from him. So what Globant is doing is, I mean, if there are, let's say, 2000 people working remotely, okay, they're doing artificial intelligence and they're actually analyzing that if you met this person at the coffee counter, would you like him or not? Okay, and they're actually finding that each individual maybe has a possibility of 15 people who are similar backgrounds. So they will set you up. And Globant says that we ensure that every Friday, everybody is meeting somebody they have not met before. And they will tell you that, look, Neeti, you're going to meet Lata at 3 o'clock and you're going to have a half an hour conversation. And by the way, here are the things that you should know about Lata. Same thing will go to Lata saying you're meeting Neeti, this is what you need to know. So you're already primed about stuff. And they're finding that almost 60% of these forced conversations are resulting in magic. So people are making new friends on the internet and they're interacting with each other, et cetera, et cetera. So I was telling Eric is the founder of Zoom, by the way, I mean, the platform you're using. And Eric actually spoke at the Bharat Internet Day. So we were interviewing Eric. And we asked Eric, look, I mean, what's the next greatest thing that's going to happen on Zoom? And he said, what would you like? I said, I mean, the worst thing that can happen on Zoom is, you know, you're kind of getting tired and then you see the other guy nicely sipping a cup of coffee. You know, what happened to the coffee break? He said, what do you do like then? I said, at least I'd like to smell the damn guy's coffee. He said, okay, doing that. Can you believe it? Zoom is going to enable you to smell the coffee of the guy you're talking about.
Oh, excellent.
No, but don't worry, they're working on it. Second, I remember when I first started using teleconferencing, if any of you know Cisco, telecom. And we, because we were a big customer partner of Cisco, Zensar, and we used to have this telepresence room. You know, telepresence room is constructed that, you know, there are three sides. So three people can be sitting here. There's this big telepresence screen and three people are sitting on the other side. One person from Tokyo, one person from London, one person from New York. By the time you're halfway into the conversation, you're actually forgetting that this is a teleconference. It's not like Zoom. It's like everything. And I've actually got, what a great idea, Mark. And you know, you go and do a high five and you say, oh my God, this guy's in Tokyo. What am I doing? He said, this is what we want to enable.
Yeah.
When you have a great conversation and you say, hey, Neeti, that was fun. Actually, feel your hand when I touch the screen. So what are they doing? I mean, they're just enabling two, they're using two senses. They're using sight and sound.
Yeah.
What we are not using is smell. What we are not using is touch. He says, we're going to enable, not enable, simulate. Okay. So I think very, very interesting. And AI will predict that if that guy looks like he's drinking South Indian filter coffee, you can actually smell South Indian filter coffee.
Yeah.
But it's simulating a reality. And imagine this is the kind of stuff that we do. So that is the kind of learning experiences of the future. I think, to answer your question, the collaboration between human beings almost simulate what happens in real life without the time based, hopefully.
Yeah. And all the travel and the cost that we used to incur previously.
I still want to get onto a plane. Hello.
Yeah, I'm also waiting for my first flight out of Bangalore now. Okay, so one last question. I think we have about 5-7 minutes and I'm aware that you have a long day after this session as well. So this question reads that about the government continues to publicize that India is on its digital journey. Ministries commit to being more tech savvy and transforming to a digital world. The new NEP commits to digital transformation, but the government isn't moving, skilling in, you know, using digital technologies. Do you think it's the bureaucracy that is afraid to bite the bullet, or it's just that it will not happen in our country?
See, everything happens in our country, but it happens very
soon.
Means of God. Okay. So I remember when I moved to Pune, and if any of you know Pune, I live in a place called Kalyani Nagar. Kalyani Nagar now is the hub of activity where all the partying happens in Koregaon Park, Kalyani Nagar. But when I moved here in 2001, people said I was crazy. And I moved here because my best friend was this guy called Amit Kalyani. He said, oh, where do you live in Kalyani Nagar? So I did. And people said, oh, only mad people. Because if you know Pune, Kalyani Nagar is beyond the river. And beyond the river is only the lunatic asylum and the Yerwada jail. So you have the jail, you have the lunatic asylum, and you have Kalyani Nagar. So that was what it was. And I remember, you know, and our fortunately, our office was just down the road, meaning down the highway called Ahmednagar Road. And the road was a cart track. So really, and I remember talking to the commissioner at that time. And he said, no, please see this plan. You know, within 2 years, this will be a 6-lane road. You'll have no problems, et cetera, et cetera. So I was very happy. 2 years didn't happen. It finally happened in 2012. So, I mean, it took about 10 years, 11 years. Sometimes it happens. In India, I mean, that is why we have all these Upanishads and the sadhus and everybody else. It teaches you infinite patience, okay? Patient, everything happens in India. Digital India, to give you an example, okay? I don't know how many of you are aware. This concept of digital India and what they called the National Optic Fiber Network was aired 10 years back.
Yeah.
About 6 years back, they changed the name to BharatNet. Okay, nothing happened. I mean, the fiber optic network was still not, and I had gone long ahead. Recently, Prime Minister Modi, in the speech of August, again called it NOFN, National Optic Fiber. Mm. What's the vision? If I ask you a quiz, I'm sure many of you won't know the answer. But do you know how many gram panchayats are there in this country? 250,000. Each gram panchayat, roughly 3-4 villages. So 600,000 villages. Ideally, every gram panchayat should get 100 Mbps internet. Then this country changes completely. Agriculture, healthcare, everything will change, because what you're seeing in financial services called the India Stack, that's part of digital India. That's the kind of concept we're giving them. So when India becomes a $5 trillion GDP, which is what Prime Minister Modi has said, obviously it's not going to happen in 2024, maybe 2028. But inside that $5 trillion GDP is embedded $1 trillion digital economy. How is this $1 trillion digital economy going to happen? 350 billion will happen by the IT and the industry growing from 200 billion to 350. 650 billion will happen through the India Stack. So that's what I'm saying. Now, just if you imagine digitally connected healthcare, agriculture, manufacturing, retail, e-commerce, of course, that will be 650 billion. When that happens, the whole country is completely transformed. Jobs will change, skills will change, everything. So I'm saying, will it happen by 2024? No. I genuinely believe it can happen by 2030. It needs to happen. Because the minute you say Atmanirbhar and everything else, so I think I have some faith. I mean, I have a great faith in the bureaucracy. I mean, some of them may be slow, but I think the typical IAS officer wants to do stuff for this. Politicians, okay, less said the better, but there are some good politicians who will make that happen. And worry about the politicians. I mean, if we make good things, like we are doing in our social work, I mean, like this Lighthouse Communities Foundation, which I now run, I mean, it's now moving. We've transformed Pune, we are taking it to Mumbai, Delhi, Hyderabad, Chennai. We know that we will impact maybe 20 cities in the next 2 years. And all with the help of government, with public-private partnerships, trusting the government and making sure they trust us. I think that's the kind of change that you have to see. Let me make one last statement. I think there's too much cynicism in our country. Just for maybe 1 year, open your mind and say, I will believe what people tell me. Okay. And believe that they will do good stuff. Don't think that they will try and fool you. And don't try and fool them absolutely. And I tell you that your life will be a better place. So it's more powerful. The word trust is nowadays more powerful than love. Love is a great, great entity also. But if you trust and love people, you'll find that they reciprocate. And I think that's a great way for even human resource people, or L&D people, to build better trusting organizations, societies, and the country.
Sure. And as usual, Ganesh, I think such an interesting conversation. I could go on and on. But there's a lot you need to do for the day. Your weekend is still not starting. So thank you very much. There are some unanswered questions, and maybe we'll reach out to you to get your views on those questions and send
feel,
it out.
You feel free, Neeti, to post my email ID on this chat. So anybody who asks me, just feel free to send me a mail. No problem at all.
Absolutely.
But thank you so much. Always a pleasure.
Thank you. It was wonderful. And thank you once again.